ever went wrong in Jesus' name.
Praise the Lord, everyone.
God bless you, everyone.
Psalmist David declared, "Behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity." And he concludes by saying that it's in unity that we can command the blessing, even life for evermore. It's just so good to see everyone, and I count it a privilege to be here today another time and to be standing in this sacred desk and to greet our pastor and bishop, Bishop Dunn, Mother Dunn, and to Elder Waldron and to all the other ministers and everybody, choir, musicians, and our friends who have come to worship today. This is the first Sunday of November. We're not going to see another Sunday like this. And so we have come to bless the name of the Lord. We bring you greetings from New York and Bishop Barnes and those in the Bronx. And I certainly bring you greetings from Bishop Thompson in Jamaica. We were there just a couple of weeks ago.
Yes, Lord.
And we just bless God for everyone. You're looking good. And the Lord bless you. Time is far spent. And we came on an assignment just to encourage the church. It's a word of encouragement today from the book of Hebrews, chapter number 6, of the lesson that was read. Praise the Lord. From the lesson that was read, Hebrews chapter number 6, we read the lesson in its entirety, but allow me to pick up from verse number 17 through verse number 20, just to be contextual. And 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and the very last verse, verse number 18. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I just enjoyed the singing of the choirs this morning. Words of assurance to the body of Christ. Praise the Lord. Hebrews chapter 6, verse 17 through to verse number 20. Listen to these words. Wherein God, willing more abundantly to show unto the heirs of promise the immutability of his counsel, confirmed it by an oath, that by two immutable things in which it was impossible for God to lie, we might have a strong consolation, who have fled for refuge to lay hold upon the hope set before us, which hope we have as an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast, and which entereth unto that within the veil. Whether the forerunner is for us, entered even Jesus, made a high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. And 1 Thessalonians 4 and the last verse, very proverbial verb, it says, wherefore comfort one another with these words. Comfort one another with these words. I want to share with us today from the subject, the quality of our hope. The quality of our hope. The quality of our hope. The only promise to the church that is yet unfulfilled is the next imminent move of God in the earth, which is the rapture. It is one of the greatest miracles that is yet to be seen. It's going to be so phenomenal because you can only imagine finitely how that God will develop, if you will, some kind of capsule that will usher the body of Christ through the stratosphere to a place that is called home. When you think about it,
yes, Lord,
it blows your mind.
Amen.
God, how are you going to do it? I can understand when he said he would give us the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
Every now and then I hear you speaking in other tongues. But when it comes to the hope of the rapture,
Lord,
I want to be there. 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 We came all this way, not necessarily this morning for theology, but we came to encourage.
That's right.
I didn't talk to Elder Waldron, and I didn't talk to the choir director, but the sons of Zion were aptly for this morning.
Amen.
That God is about ready to take his children home.
Yes.
It might not seem like he's ready. The skies might look fair. Friends are near.
But he's ready.
But I came to tell you this morning that he's about ready to blow the trumpet. He's about ready to do it. 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 Said he would do it 2,000 years ago.
Uh-huh.
He has not done it yet. But I'm assured in my mind that he's going
to
do it. I'm sure that he's going to do it. When you read the word of God, it testified to the fact that he's going to do it.
He
told us in his words that he would come. And he came.
Oh, Lord. God,
if Jesus didn't come, we would not be here this morning.
That is right.
If Jesus didn't come, we could not sing about salvation.
No.
But he came. And when he came here, the angel said, call his name Jesus.
That is correct.
For he shall save his people.
That is right.
I don't know about you this morning, but I'm saved.
Yes.
I said I'm saved.
Yes.
And I'm not speculating to the fact. I know I'm saved.
Thank you.
The old church, they used to sing a song, if you ask me how I'm saved. You know, some folks can't explain how they're saved, but if you ask me how I'm saved, I'll tell you how. Saved like the apostles. I'm saved like Cornelius. I've repented of my sins. Been baptized in Jesus' name, and I'm filled with the Holy Ghost. I'm saved. I'm saved. I'm saved. I'm saved. I'm saved. If you find another way to salvation, then tell me about it. But the Bible said that's the only way. There is no other way given under heaven whereby it must be saved. The name Jesus,
oh God,
is the greatest name, the highest name. Sometimes we praise the Lord by saying hallelujah, but the highest praise is Jesus. And you say Jesus, all of heaven comes into motion. When you say Jesus, the greatest name is the highest name. It's the only name that can save. And Jesus got here, the first miracle that earth saw was that a virgin was with child. Bible said that angel said to Mary, Mary, that which is in thy womb is of the Holy Ghost. What makes the Church of Jesus Christ different from any other movement is the fact that the same miracle that was in Mary is the same miracle. It's the same miracle that's in the church, because the day you spoke in other tongues, It was like receiving the miracle that Mary received. Paul, no wonder Paul speaks about this hope, and he said it's the hope of glory. Didn't only leave it there, but he said it's Christ in me. You got to know you got Christ. You got to know. Nobody can tell you that you got it. You got to know when you got Christ. There's an anointing that's in you. There's an anointing
that's
running up and down through your body. You got to know. Brother testified that he came into the house of God today and he feel right. Testified of the fact that the sound that he hears and the feeling of heaven. Some folks are about ready to give up this. Hallelujah. Some folks are about ready, hallelujah to God, to throw in the towel. But I'm glad that he's here, because he's a testimony to the fact that this joy that I have, the world didn't give it to me. He's a testimony to the fact this morning that Jesus is alive. And he's well in spite of what you're going through. Jesus is alive and he's well in spite of the difficulty. When you got the anointing, when you got the Holy Ghost, you know, and this is why you can't cause no devil to rob you. This is why you can't afford nobody to cause you to get discouraged. This is why you can't afford nobody to get you into a mood where you get vexed, because when you have the Holy Ghost, there is nothing that nobody can bring upon the body of Christ to get me discouraged, because I know in whom I believe and I'm persuaded that he's able. Oh God, I came to encourage you this morning, because some folks are giving up in their minds. Some folks are discouraged. But when you have the Holy Ghost, you can't be discouraged. When you got the hope of glory, you can't be discouraged. Trouble in your way, you gotta cry sometime, but you know that Jesus will fix it. This is why I came to church this morning, not because everything is all right, but because I know Jesus will fix it. Oh, he's gonna fix it after a while, children. I don't know who I'm talking to, but I just came to tell you he's gonna fix it after a while. Don't be discouraged, don't be dismayed. He's gonna fix it, he's gonna fix it, he's gonna fix it, he's gonna fix it. Then in the text that we understand here, Paul writing to his brothers, book of Hebrews, he writes concerning the superiority of Christ. He writes concerning the fact that there is no one greater than Jesus Christ. He writes to a church, early church of the first century, and received the Lord Jesus Christ just like us. And as they had received the Lord Jesus Christ, they were persecuted, because in the early church, most of them had left from their tradition. They had left from Judaism and they had accepted this great apostolic truth. They were persecuted, number one, by their own family, by their own kingdom. Some of us are here and we're going through that kind of persecution, because for some strange reason, when you are a member of the apostolic church, there seems to be an unusual persecution that comes against you. But I want to encourage you this morning that when you're persecuted, it means you're doing something right. God, I want to tell you this morning that when you're going through the fire for the name of Jesus, it means that you're on the right track. They were persecuted by their kinfolks. How that they had changed from the tradition of the elders and had gone over to this new way, this new doctrine concerning Jesus Christ. Secondly, they were persecuted by the Romans. The Romans were the governors of those days. They were